to get in on that zombie craze back then. This is a fucking DLC for Lost Judgment, the Crydo Files. I've actually heard it's pretty good. I might watch it or something. I didn't have it at the time. I don't even know if it was out, maybe. This is Streets of Kamurocho, which I have installed. It was like a... when I think Capcom, or not Capcom, Sega was doing a bunch of like goofy... like, they'd only be out for a couple weeks games. And this was like one of them or some shit. You can't even get it on the store anymore. It's a free game. Like, it's not available on Steam anymore. It was just a free Streets of Rage game for Kuza. I haven't played it yet. I've been meaning just to kind of knock it out because I think it's really short. Yeah. Literally 21 minutes. I don't even know if it's any good. I could literally just play it right now. I don't know if I will. Just to put it on here, man. Super different. Yakuza 1 and 2. Okay, now this is a thing like a lot of Yakuza veterans and shit will be like, okay, man. Kiwami 1 and 2, it's not the same. It is very much not the same. But in some ways it is the same. To the point where I don't know if I want to go play these. Like, they're different in the sense that these are more like moody. There's more camera angles that are more set. That draw a certain kind of atmosphere. Obviously stuff like the combat's different. Subquests and stuff. But they are different. And some people will say Kiwami 2 is fucked and Yakuza 2 is awesome. I don't care enough to replay these stories. Maybe I've been far enough away from Yakuza 1 and 2 that I could go back and kind of experience them and kind of just re-experience those like lower stakes, lower scope stories. See how they did it on PS2. And just kind of bust through them. I'm not too worried. I get that it's a big deal for a lot of Yakuza people. I got a lot to play. I played the Kiwamis. I like the Kiwamis. Fine. Are these better? Very well. I played a lot of Yakuza games already. All these on the bottom I played. So. And then this is the original version of Isshin. The new version of Isshin does change what each character looks like. They replace all the characters with it replaces old characters with new characters that are like, you know, like Saijima or something. They're the same characters in a way, but they look different, talk, that kind of thing. In some ways, some of the screenshots I've seen, it's a downgrade, the new one in visuals. Higher fidelity, but maybe not as good art direction, but... and obviously they're going to have different mini-games and all that kind of stuff, so... different, but I'd imagine this is even less different. That's kind of the explanation for those and why I haven't played them or don't plan on playing them. Everything on the left... I plan on playing. Everything on the right, from online and on, I don't care. Anyways, I don't have like a list of like... I might even take one of these. It's just kind of a general list. I don't like having Fs. Like, that means the game's like just dog shit. Like, it's shit compared. We're doing a comparative list. I'll let you know if it's just shit. We'll just go left to right. I think Zero is probably one of the best ones. I think that's a pretty common take. Now, if I went back to Zero today, would I feel the same way? Probably not. Because of Yakuza fatigue setting in is a real thing. I really wish Binary, you know, was a... goofy. We'll just put it in there. I don't know why this fucker. I mean, maybe it's like supposed to be technically like in the same world. Binary Domain is like a sci-fi third-person shooter they did. Yeah, Yakuza 0 is just, and I've gone and re-experienced a lot of these games not that long ago. Watched a lot of, like, fucking super long essays on these and some playthroughs here and there, so. I think 0 has just a really strong low-stakes, low-scope story. High stakes, but, with a character. I think seeing Kiryu when he's younger, at an interesting time period, the bubble with all the money going around in Japan and stuff, and a different side to Majima. Well, I didn't know at the time. This was my first one. I think they just are very well shot type of, you know, very great cinematography that is very tuned into the character work. I'm in a story that really knows to always focus on character. I think you get a lot of backstory and like characterization for some of these guys that carries through the whole series. If you've played the ones that came out before this, because this came out after 5 or after 4, I think after 5. I think it carries throughout the series, or if you play it then, it enhances the rest of it. I think it fits in nice. It's interesting. I think it's a game where you start getting really big major mini games. 5 is, but 0 is where a lot of them really get polished with P. The locations are just really clean. The subquests are all a lot of fun. Most people, this is their first Yakuza game. The bombastic, over the top, melodramatic characters, the crazy antics, the mix of comedy and the saccharine sweet, like, fucking, you know, character moments and all these different tones that are just cranked up to 1,000 are fresh. These are all new feeling things. There's not a lot of series that do it quite like Yakuza does. The really strong cinematography, mocapping and facial animations, and how it is this kind of like melodramatic crime drama soap opera thing, like, it's all just kind of hitting you, boom, it's all its new thing. It's really in a great package to deliver that to first. Being able to jump between two different characters ends up helping with pacing a lot, how they intertwine. It just feels real good. If you're gonna try the series out, most people will be like, hey, go do 0, give it a go. If you don't like 0, just stop. You're not gonna like the rest of them. 0 is one of the better ones. You put up with a lot of okay to like whatever games to kind of keep riding that series. If you want to go through the whole thing. None of them are just like bad that I've played, but 0 is definitely a hype. Give that one a go. Some people would say you should play it in maybe chronological order or release order. 0 doesn't come out till after 5. I think you should just play 0. If this is somebody watching this series for the first time, it's fine. Like I said, I think it enhances a lot of the characters. Nishiki and stuff in 1 comes off a little odd because of how much strong character work it gets in 0. Him kind of being a little bit of a goofy goober in 1 ends up being a little odd, but it fits enough. There's time jumps and stuff because Kiryu's in prison after the start of the first. So yeah, it's just the all around. I don't want to break into it too much, but. Some, like I said, Yakuza fatigue, there is a lot. You're going to see stuff in 0 that you'll still see in 8. You're going to see stuff that's like in 3 or some shit that's still in 8. Like, there is a fatigue. Like I said, the skeleton is rotting, but it's got a new skin. Sometimes it's got new muscles too, but it's the skeleton's dying in a way. It makes it sound like the series is dying. The series is still very quality. I like it. I play them all. So if I went back and played 0 now, there's probably elements of it I'd be like, oh, okay. I think the strong points. Like, if I had another zero now, like, just really good character work, despite the same kind of, like, trappings, that'd be great. One. So, when I put these on the list, I don't know exactly where they're gonna be at the end. I'm just putting them compared to what else is on the list. I would put one. Is it a big league over? This is Kiwami one, but also. Which people usually have less issues with. Is it leagues? I mean, it's definitely worse. So. It's extremely important. This is going to be hard to compare to a certain extent because they're really similar. the subquests and stuff are just much worse, right? They're not very, they're almost all the subquests are just here to get tricked by somebody. He fell for a, you know, oh, he fell for a con or a scheme or, you know, it was just to show that the Kamurocho is a rough place. And people, that's kind of all the subquests. It's also a bit to find a lot of them. I don't remember if this one actually had the detector or not. Some of these games, it's like you have to like get a guide. It's not one you really do a lot of sub stuff for. I mean, I did them all, but like it's what. Kwame in particular has like a sequel to like Pocket Racer and stuff like that, which is cute. But it also has a Cabaret sequel, or is that Kwame 2? I don't remember. So there's some major mini games that get reused or get sequels in them. End up laying down, fall asleep. Are you laying down right now? But so the main story, like I said, the scope, how it starts the Haruka thing, some of the strong moments with Kiryu, it's like they're nice, you know, it's good stuff. It's not on the same level of like storytelling. There's some goofy shit and some conspiracy stuff, but it does its job. It's clean enough. It's not a crazy game. It sets the tone and what the characters are about. It's cool. It's hard to really think back. I don't know. They didn't really fully do it. He looks like a zombie now. I think he's getting treatment. Or there's like chemo, or maybe the cancer's getting to him. He's trying to live, essentially, is what's going on. And he's got his actual name instead of the fake name. And his daughter came and saw him. Well, she didn't see him. She saw his bed. He was getting treatment. Whatever, they're saving that for another game. In a way, he got a good end. They just didn't do much with it. Kind of wish they would just give him the full happy ending already. Find out the next game or something. So yeah, I don't know. Yakuza 1, Kiwami. It's clean. It's important. Can't give it too much shit. It's the first game. It's really just its main story, which isn't like crazy, but it's cute enough. It's got a novelty. Yakuza 2. I put Kiwami 2 up higher than this, maybe. This is just relative to each other right now. I'm Kiwami 2 on my. Much better story. One of the better stories in any general. To, you know, the big factions, the Omi versus like Tojo. Ryuji kind of being interesting. He's got a little bit of love interest stuff going on. Just a relatively low scope, just, well, slightly higher scope than like one, but like a lowish scope, kind of just drama, crime thing. Very just what Yakuza is all about. Very focused there. Just clean, much better side stuff. Well, Kiwami 2 has like Majima Construction, which is one of the worst things they've ever done. Super, I hate that fucking minigame. But the you know, that's new stuff. Generally though, Kiwami's 2 is, I mean, you don't have to do all the mod construction, has very little value. throughout the series, so. I think it's cool. I don't know. It's been a bit since this. Cool. It's clean up three. I don't know, dude. I don't like the whole lot. I think three is super important. I think it's a low point for the series. One of the lower points for me. Although I think it's been outdone lately by some of these other ones. Granted, I did go like from the Kiwamis and Zeros, so this is the oldest one I played combat-wise, and it doesn't feel very good. Very stiff looking. I guess I did mention the combat in the old ones. Zero's stances are really neat. It's a cool way to take a system that isn't that fluid and great feeling, and at least throw some spice in there. Everybody's got all these different stances and spice, and you're beating dudes up in two hits in a stylish, different way all the time, and that's what you're all about. You just want to brawl in a bunch of wacky ways, right? Just kind of have fun with it. Kiwami keeps the stances. The original did not have those. Kiwami 2 goes more for the 6 style. It has this weird counter rock, paper, scissors thing with the colors and this kind of shit. It's also super easy to break. A lot of these are. These old ones, if you're not just chugging all the time, you could give yourself like buffs with like muscle soda and like Kiwami 2 and shit. Like the Kiwami 1 had Majima everywhere, I think. That wasn't that. Or was that? Wait. But man, Tiger Drop was. With muscle sodas, I mean, you literally have one shot bosses, so. These all have a lot of broken, sloppy combat, but at their best, they're just fun brawlers where you have a lot of variety. Like, 3, very stiff. You're gonna get shot by guns thousands of times and fall on your ass for like 10 seconds at a time, and it's gonna feel like ass, and you don't have a whole lot of movement, and there's some guarding. But it kind of feels like shit, and then when you finally start hitting an enemy, and this happens throughout the series usually, but you start hitting an enemy and like you'll hit him twice, like you'll open up a string of combos, right? And he'll just guard in the middle of it. You don't even have like infinite combos, but they still don't even let you get like a full combo out, right? Like it just feels like shit. When you compare that to like even of the time, like Devil May Cry action games. God of War already been out, which is just a bun masher to a certain extent, but like PS3, right? I mean, we're getting like Bayonetta soon. It's like, it just feels like fucking dog shit. It's not like it's gonna stop you from playing them. It's just a part of Yakuza, right? It's not 90% of the game is combat, right? But in 3, it's more combat than it is in most of them. Is they really don't start hitting their stride with variety, and then big time on the minigames. 4 gets more variety because you get new characters, and then like, start going really wild. And then 0 comes out after 5. So 3 is one of the most important games in the series. It's where you get the orphanage. It's where Kiryu really get his, Oh, dude, the hardest fishing, yeah. The fucking... Where I had to not blink for like an hour trying to get fucking tuna fish, dude. Yeah, that shit fucking gnarly. But yeah, so you're in a new city. I don't remember if you go back to Kamurocho. This one. Okinawa. I don't remember exactly. Orphanage on the beach. It's about kind of Kiryu, his life outside of Yakuza world. I mean, he's obviously gets back in this, taking care of kids for a lot of it, meeting the local people, kind of being sort of a father, sort of getting ties to this kind of life, taking care of Haruka and stuff. And these kids, it is important for the rest of the series. It is insanely important. Kiryu, it's a huge motivator or a chip used against him in like most of the games. After the so like you don't just skip three. Like you could go read online what it's about, but you need to understand like the emotional connection, seeing it, right? Like the stuff they do well in Yakuza, like you need to see, you need to. I think Yakuza is pretty important on that front in its own right. Some people really hate the orphanage part of the story. It's slow. You're not meeting a whole lot of people. You're just fooling around. I don't mind it too much. I think the pace of it could be tightened in a way, but I think the bonds that you and characterizing and learning about all the characters, the kids stuff is really important. And how after you've played the, you know, maybe the three games before, if you started with Zero, kind of where Kiri's at. It's interesting enough, and they build up guys enough where by the time when the action really starts getting going, it's cute. You've got enough ties to some of them. I think it's a game where some of the melodrama gets a little goofy, like 10-minute death segments. I mean, at least people actually die. But I think it's the game that is also where they start kicking up the conspiracy thing, and it never comes back from that. It's where it starts escalating. We're getting into sort of these underground weapon Illuminati Black Dahlia thing. It's still tied to like Yakuza. But like this is also a game that was about like chill orphanage times and stuff, and it's funny. These moments in this series are really funny. Beautiful eyes and all that shit with like the clone thing going on in Yakuza 3. But like, so it's okay in a way, but it's only okay because it like ends up being goofy enough. When these games start getting like not funny, like 8, about how fucking stupid the conspiracy shit is, then they're just kind of crappy conspiracy stories that have ballooned out to try to keep them exciting to the point where they like, I feel like, grab background and up. So I think 3 is what starts that. Some people find Mine or whatever his name is one of the best villains. He's alright. He's charismatic. He's a bad guy who's a little different. I don't know, at this point they've kind of done that. I don't care much anymore. I was not a big fan though. I think he's one of the shittiest. It's combat, it's the encounters, a lot of just shit that knocks you on your ass, and it's just not really fun to play against. A lot of combo break. Just kind of boring fights with nothing fancy going on. You don't have the styles, you don't have the breadth of like things you can pick up and fool around with. If I remember right, leveling up is just linear. It's been a while. Side content's okay. This is before they've made like major mini games. The Kwamis bring in major minigames from like Zero and stuff. This one doesn't have anything. Cabaret stuff's really bad in 3. Subquests are fine. They exist. They're nothing fancy. I can't really remember many of them. Not like I can with Zero and stuff like that. Or like 5. I don't know. I don't have the hottest, most detailed take on it. I find, like I said, while funny, the ballooning of the story, sitting there for like 40 minutes listening to some politician exposition dump the entire story to you. It's really funny, but it's not good. Like, but it is good at times, right? It's kind of like 8, where at times it's got important. I find the beginning cool. And, you know, it's still got that Yakuza flair. It's not like it's a bad game or anything. Like, not quite as feature-rich, but it's also not as long of a game. next up would be Yakuza 4. Yeah, Yakuza 4, I would say I like this one better. Probably better than 1, but maybe not like wildly better than 1. Yeah, so Yakuza 4 is the one that introduces new playable characters for the first time. Unless you played 0. But 0 came out after 5. So Yakuza 4, yeah, 4 playable characters: Kiryu, Saejima, Akiyama, and the police guy. It was all about like counter defense shit. They kind of barely mention him in 8 here. I wonder what he's up to, you know? I'm just like, he's got a famous subquest where you got like the revolver to your head or whatever, and it's like, how are you going to pull the trigger, right? Fearlessly, or, you know, that kind of thing. And it's like, it's an interesting subquest out of nowhere. So I think 4, I definitely like it better than like the first one and 3. The variety's good. They all play a little different in a way. Saejima's like big heavy charge attacks. Akiyama's like kicks. Kiryu's, you know, just kind of the punch clean guy. The other guy's like a defense dude. So in terms of gameplay, it's still generally the same, but you know, they play all a little different, which can be fun. Sometimes not as good as each other. It's something fresh on the gameplay front. You're getting different locations in the city, or just different locations in general. Different stories, because you're learning about some of these guys. You know, I feel like Yakuza games tend to be some of the best moments are when they're introducing a character, right? Think about like Akiyama's intro. Like, you don't know anything about these guys, but they just have this charisma, and they're just in these cool scenes, and you just want to know, like, what's up with this guy? Who is this guy? You know, he's cool as fuck, right? Like, just really strong scenes that, like, take their time and let the characters breathe and do cool shit. Like, I feel like it was always super strong in the beginning, man, with their character. It starts getting goofy, but... So this has, like, 4 of those, right? So that's pretty cool. It all ties them all in by the end, and it's all conspiracy bullshit. I don't even remember the full story. I think this was the one with, like, the police chief was a part of it. What's this? Yeah, and you like... fight Daigo, and you also fight the police chief, and then you fight the other guy, and everybody like takes one or something. Like, like, I barely remember that part. The main story is kind of whatever. The characters, the freshness of combat, still being kind of a similar way to like divvy out how you like progress through the content, like, and the leveling up. That's kind of where it's at. It's Kamurocho and stuff again. I don't find it like a super high point, but I think having a new cast and a new people kind of have Kiryu and everybody bounce off of a bit is solid there. So it's got a cool enough story. Like I said, it starts cool. Yeah, I mean, the prison break and stuff with Saejima is a little slow, but like there's some cool moments there. They tie in some interesting characters, and it's definitely more of a beginning Yakuza game is exciting than the late game because of the conspiracy stuff. Not really a crazy one. There's not a whole lot of wild side content. Because there's only like, you know, you'll get like 10 to 15 subquests per person. But I still find those to be interesting enough because they get to flesh out characters more. Like Saejima's like, he's been in prison for like, ever. you know, he doesn't know, like, what the fuck is going on half the time. He's like a fish out of water, and it's, like, really interesting, and how he's just, like, super, like, bullheaded guy, and it's kind of fun there. This has some of the most goofy twists in the series. I do remember, was this Rubber Bullets? I think this was Rubber Bullets. So there's some fucking stupid shit in it that's funny, but it really does end up just kind of being more kind of stock conspiracy, just fun shit. I like this was Rubber Bullets. Sometimes I mix up this and Five because it's a lot of the same characters. But yeah, it's got some funny, crazy twist moments. It's a fun story to go through. You know, you haven't played every fucking Yakuza game at this point. It can be kind of entertaining on that front. You're not totally tired of like any of the trope or anything, and it's still got some funny bullshit and spice to hit you with. Like I said, not great side content in the major minigame category, but cool enough little sub quest, mainly to kind of flesh out each. I'm trying to remember what major minigames even were. I don't think this was at the point where they actually were doing major minigames. I think it was just basic stuff. It's just like typical shit, like hostesses and mahjong and show karaoke. It's not really like a... Not that kind of... wasn't that kind of... Yeah. That's not until Five. Yeah, I don't know. I guess that's what I think. I'm not too crazy. Five... kind of depends on who you are in Five. I think Five generally hits higher for a lot of people. Yeah, it's like Goto or something, probably is lower. But I like Five for... There's definitely problems with Five, but Five's breadth of content, its jump into having way more developed mini games and side stuff, even more characters, and willingness to do goofy shit, like having an entire playable like idol arc for a character that you know, like you just don't have a choice, you have to do this whole rhythm idol arc. I like a lot of the ending stuff. There's some strong emotional shit, a lot of kind of like parenthood type of stuff, which I think is cool. I think Baseball Man's story is really awesome. It's nice seeing Daigo get some stuff. It's always cool to see Saejima back, even though he kind of gets the exact same story with the prison break and everything again. And then Akiyama and all that kind of is melded into Haruka's story and shit. But it's another kind of conspiracy one. It gets up there with some goofy shit again, but it tries to keep it a little bit more in focus with the character writing, in my opinion. And there's so... It has the most locations. There's like 8 fucking cities or some shit. Not even 8. Every character has like their own city thing going on. You know, you go to the place where Zero's at, you're in Kamurocho, you're in, like, the snow place, you're in, was it Yokohama in that? I don't remember. Baseball guy, you're in a new city for, like, every character, right? So, and then a lot of them culminate in, like, Kamurocho stuff, so. It is the biggest Yakuza game, probably, pretty much. I mean, maybe, like, 7 or 8, technically, in a way bigger. Five feels the biggest because of how I'll just sidetrack and get. It gets a little out there with some of its conspiracy stuff and the father Yakuza Omi thing, but it's got some big moments, some of the cons. and all that, and how they tie some of that crazy all in, and what it's supposed to mean to each person. I generally like it. It's got its issues, like I said. It does get lost in the sauce, and it can get stupid and not make sense. And if you don't like the diversions, right? I mean, well, you can just ignore them. You know, that's a lot of what's cool about it. Some of the cities, you know, they're definitely going for quantity over quality sometimes. Like Saijima City is neat because it's a little different, but it's just like a straight line or two, right? Like, it's ambitious. You can tell that's where really the series started to twink, crank it up a bit. Then they polish that with D and Zero, with the jumping of tones and goofiness and major side content. Yeah, see, I mean, that's just like, that's something I would like, but like, yeah, Goto hates that shit. So it's one of those things, like, generally people like Yakuza 5, but there are things that, like, you might not like. So, I mean, a lot of people don't like the title. I don't mind it because I'm like, I like the variety. I'm invested in the Haruka thing a little bit more. Maybe it's not awesome, but it pays off by the end of it. Yeah, it's one of those things, right? It kind of just depends a bit. Little light in here. Dream was one of those that, like, I like. I think I liked the world building, the atmosphere. It wasn't a pure walk and talk type of game. But I also just like that kind of... anyways. Yeah, so I think 2 would probably be up there. I might put 2 up in that same category. But there's just something a little bit, I don't know, the Heart of 5 and stuff that I just kind of... In some ways. Like I said, 5 gets very lopsided and goofy, but to me a lot of the time, especially when you get later in this series, like, you're after that variety to a certain extent, and this game knows it. Like, all the different playable characters and escapades, and like, you're playing Saijima, and you're like, you get out of prison and shit, and like, you can go on like a 10-hour story about hunting. And it's like a full hunting mini game, and you're like, it's kind of cool, man. You know, or like, you could go do like an Initial D, like, taxi mini game. And these mini game stories, sometimes, you know, like the taxi one, they will be reused the format in later games, right? Like, there's the 4 taxi guys you get, or the 5. They don't do that really with the hunting one and shit, but it's like, you know. There's stuff there that feels at the time a bit more fresh. You know, they're making a leap to try to do more big, kind of interesting stuff. I think that's pretty cool. Have fun with it. Yeah, you know, like I said, it can be lopsided, it can be goofy. I think when push comes to shove, the emotional moments get across how I need them to, but it's not as clean as 0. It's not as polished as 0 was there. So I think you could put 2 up in this branch too. Maybe I will. 6. I would probably put that right above 3. 6 is considered a low point. Probably for a good reason. So this is them going back to solo Kiryu. You're like, okay. Right. So... No stances. New Dragon Engine. It's very jank a lot of the time. You know, it looks good at times, but it can be jank with how some of the combat works, how some of the physics are. That they've kind of scoped back the combat a bit. It's just kind of his, like, classic kind of beat-em-up combat. There's not really, like, variety. And like I said, just core Yakuza combat's not that great, so like the variety's kind of what's nice. That's what was nice about 4 and 5, and 0 has the stances and stuff, right? So it's like they knew variety was kind of the way to go, and then they tried to dial it back to like improve the core, but it's not really there, so you're kind of missing that variety. But it does its job. The new location, very this kind of dreamy, sort of comfy seaside town. I liked that part of it. It was a neat new area. Entertaining. The sub quests are okay. I like some of the major mini game stuff, like the underwater railgun section where you're fighting giant psycho fucking like fish and sea monsters and stuff. Shit like baseball didn't really do anything for me. What were the other major mini games? Oh, Clan Creators sucks. Anything kind of back and come roaches, kind of whatever. Was there any other major mini games? So the thing with 6 is, I feel like the major mini game stuff is a little shittier. Maybe it was. The sub quests are fine, but not super crazy. The combat's a little worse. It looks better in some ways, but it's a little off in others. I think with 6-1, where Kiryu felt like he kind of has lifeless face sometimes. I mean, he looked like an ogre in like 3 and shit, but... yeah, so it's a little awkward in some of those ways. And the main story, you're just kind of like, alright man, you know, it's another conspiracy thing that reaches up in the government. It's another big goofy twist. It's still character focused. Obviously it's about like Haruka and stuff, and figuring out what happened to her and where she's at, and like, you know, so you're invested in that respect because you're invested in Haruka's first game. But I don't know. It's not like an atrocious game. Like I said, it's kind of like this 3. It's just another Yakuza story. It sets up some stuff for the rest of these. Every Kiryu game after this is tied hard into this story. The end of it. Since the story's not that great, that kind of hurts these other games a little bit. Because it's the Daidoji shit, and you're just like, I don't give a fuck. Like, I don't care about any of that. But it's a huge deal, so they kind of like move away from the specifics of it by 8 and Gaiden, and it's kind of just about that he is kind of working for this shadow faction. But
so I don't know,
it's okay. It's one of those that just, it's got some fun characters, it's got the cinematography, it's got the Yakuza formula in a new place that's kind of comfy, but it doesn't do anything in particular super well, and you're starting to kind of get used to the formula a little too much at that point. Like, you were used to the formula probably around 3, 4, maybe, but then 5, you know, kicks it in the ass a little bit. Like, ooh, you know, there's a lot of stuff going on, and then 6 is like, kind of doesn't, and he's like, alright. Like, now it's just like back kind of what I'm used to, but spread the butter a bit thin here. You're asking yourself, like, you know, I still like Kiryu a lot, but you're asking yourself, you know, where's the series going from here? So it's one of those that I think suffers a bit more from being the 7th fucking game. A very similar series. Kind of jumping into new shit was kind of awkward. There's a reason that stuff like Judgment and 7 come out soon after. Anyways, 7. I'd probably put 7 up here. I think 7's pretty good. I think you give them a pass for the combat because it's the first one, and Yakuza's not really had that much great combat. It does its job. The level stuff can get a little goofy, but it's got pretty cool subquests. It's got pretty cool major mini games. pretty above average across the board there. New characters, Ichiban. I don't like him a whole lot in that one, but he's still fun. He's more wacky. He's more about friendship and getting people to help him out. Less party members. I mean, there's still a lot. It's still pretty much all the same guys, except like they add two more on in the eight, but and then Kiryu. But they get to focus on these people a lot more and their friendship as they start to kind of like Ichiban, and you know, you learn about Ichiban's story, his life. It fully characterizes him and gives you all his history. Where eight's more just kind of focused on him and kind of in a new scenario. Which I think kind of makes me like him more in a way, because you just kind of see how he is when it's not tied. In a way. I mean, it still kind of is. It's about him finding his mom, but I mean, it moves so far. So that's cool. It's a fresh coat of paint. Yokohama is super detailed, big Kamurocho style thing, but in a new area, so that's kind of fun. So yeah, I think it's just really clean overall. Trying a new kind of combat, I think it's a good way to go. My problems with 7 are like, they gotta tie it back into the old Yakuza. You know, it goes from being about kind of just him and his little Yakuza thing to the big grand conspiracy, the dissolution of all the Yakuza. We gotta get Kiryu back in there, and we gotta fight Majima, and we gotta fight Taiga, and we gotta do all this shit. And it suffers from ballooning out again, the huge sizes, and making it overly focused on the core Yakuza politics and story and all that kind of stuff, to the point where I feel like it kind of hamstrings it. Like, there's more going on than just that, like the whole Bleach Japan thing, and like is essentially like his brother and stuff is like the bad guy and all that is interesting. And they always like to have these kind of like dual stories going on, you know, dissolution and just like you kind of wish they would just kind of move away from that a bit if they're going to start doing that, but it kind of ties back hard, in my opinion. Which then, you know, all of his friends are still really tied into what's going on, more so than I'd say the party members are in this, but it starts being about mostly, Ichiban, like, stuff. It's like, Hobo's helping, yeah, alright. I mean, I guess I didn't ask myself that too much in that one, not like this one. I think it falls a little there, but overall it's fun to do everything. And once again, the gear's not that good, the job stuff is also not that good. It's pretty much the same, and I feel like the combat takes too much time for how kind of weak it is, but hey, it does its job. I think the wackiness of it really fits. I think Ichiban being more of a silly dude, the nice kind of yin yang to Kiryu. Overall, I think it's one of the better ones. Definitely above average. It's got it. Fist of the North Star Lost Paradise. On like a personal level, I want to put it like higher in a way. If I'll put it like above. This is very personal on this one. It's not a crazy good story. It's got a lot of grindy subquests. It's not like super tightly designed, but it's just fun, man. It's just goofy fun. It's fucking Kenshiro walking in there in a fucking Yakuza city, essentially. And it's essentially like Mad Max 3. Kind of like a Thunderdome thing going on. It was like a city or whatever. I guess 2 kind of had that as well. And kind of going through this alternate history of like Fist of the North Star stuff. He'll fight some of his brothers for some reason. So it's not like a canon type of thing, but like It's just you blowing up dudes with your fingers and karate chopping guys, and it fits Yakuza perfectly. You're like fucking riding around in like dune buggies and like fucking like exploring shit, and just it's super over the top, and you know, the melodrama and like overkill kind of nature of like how Yakuza presents itself kind of fits Fist of the North Star, right? I wish this actually was like on PC. Like, I don't think anybody played this, but it's just a Yakuza game, but like with Fist of the North Star, it works really well. A lot of the subquests are just funny. A lot of the mini games are goofy. Like, instead of baseball, it's like you taking an entire fucking gridiron and like smacking bandits on motorcycles over the horizon. Like, it's still baseball, but it's like just super goofy, right? Like, I mean, the drink shaking minigame will give you carpal tunnel, but like other than that, I mean, it's a lot of fun little mini games. There's not a whole like super major ones. Like, there's a cabaret one, but instead of like managing the girls, you like beat the shit out of people who are trying to harass them, kind of thing. Like, it's just like, it's more of a Fist of the North Star, like macho crazy anime, like Yakuza. So I liked it. I think this story is a little rough. Trying to fit in like the anime manga storyline in there slightly doesn't quite work, but it's just fun. It's goofy. It's not worth doing everything. Like I said, it can get very grindy with some of its subquests, but you can generally do most of them. And I have fun with it. Is it as clean of a game as like the ones above it? Probably not, but I just had more fun with it in kind of a just fun, just pure fun kind of way. Fist of the North Star is a lot of very entertaining. So. Judgment, I'd probably put Judgment up there with these ones. I think you could argue Judgment maybe goes one lower, but generally I would say Judgment was higher up there. It is a entirely new character, a new cast that doesn't hard connect like Ichiban's story does to Kiryu and them, but it connects to, it is in Kamurocho, and it does have to do with crime conspiracy stuff a bit more. You like, it's not quite connected always hard to the Yakuza, but probably more than you'd like. It still might as well be with some of the shadowy organizations and kind of focus on you know, conspiracies and building up like either the government or there's some other kind of thing, but I like it a lot in that it is trying to do something fresh, keeping the scope low for most of it. If he's like a detective, right, who used to be like a lawyer or attorney, and his friend Kaido is like an ex-Yakuza guy, and so it's like you do get Yakuza stuff still. It's not like a full detective thing. It's very much a crime drama, but just the guys, he runs a detective agency instead of being an actual ex-con or something. I don't know, I think it's cool. I like the characters. Kaido and stuff are fun. It's still Kamurocho, it's still the same skeleton, but they go hard on the mini games. They're interesting and kind of fleshed out, different enough. Judgment's combat, a little bit more flashy, a bit more crazy, you know, taekwondo fucking karate nuts kind of flying around shit. He's got a couple style choices, just two, I think. It gives it some spice. Definitely more action movie-esque. And then they'll try to incorporate like little gadgets and stuff into how you do the main story and shit like that. There's moments like the tailing that aren't very good, but they try to make it a bit more detective-y mystery. You're essentially chasing down like a serial killer, but it's serial killer in Yakuza, you know, it's a little less, you know, brooding mystery that you're going to be guessing around. A little, I mean, it's contrived conspiracy bullshit, so, but it's cool. I think the side stuff's neat. It's a really fresh despite being in the same city. Which doesn't give it, it doesn't help its case at all, but they do what they can there. I definitely appreciate that one. In a way, I respect that more than 7 did when it came to refreshing it a bit, because at least it tried to, like, kind of separate. Oh, yeah, never mind. My foot is turned off because I've been sitting here forever. Oh. Back on, please, dudes. I mean, I don't need it on, but I just kind of like the background, I guess. Anyways, so yeah, I don't know. I like Judgment. I think it's clean. It's like all the activities are fun. Drone racing, the Fortune Street bullshit. It's just goofy fun. Not fun in the way like Fist of the North Star is, but it's a clean enough game. I do wish the main story was a little bit more mysterious, a little bit more atmosphere there. It is still kind of dipping back into that kind of Yakuza style. They can't help themselves, but it at least separates itself out from the main line, which is cool. So. Lost Judgment. I put Lost Judgment here, like, behind 7. I think it... This one's tough. So, Lost Judgment... Obviously, it brings back the main character game. New story... That takes place in Kamurocho, but also Yokohama, which is where 7 took place. This came out after 7. So you're used to the cities. You're used to the formula quite a bit. But hey, it's the new character. It's not super tied into the Yakuza stuff. I would say in some ways less so than usual. I think its mini game stuff is really interesting. It is very varied, more than any Yakuza game. It has the most mini games, I would say, because it does this thing that's about him kind of being a teacher at a high school sort of deal. And so every club in the high school is like its own mini game. There's a gaming club, there's like a racing club, there's like a bot battling club. Are all these minigames super good? No. Some of them are pretty weak, but there's so many of them, it's kind of cool. It's all about that super variety, so. That's pretty cool. I like the side quest game there. I don't remember the sub quest much. I think they're just alright. Mostly forgettable, but like the major minigame stuff is neat. It's almost worth seeing just for that. They bring back some stuff like drone racing, but it's not really there. I think maybe the Fortune Street thing came back too. So, a lot of returning stuff, which you don't care about as much. Cities, same thing. About the same combat. They clean it up maybe a little. I don't remember a whole lot of difference there. So they're not. That's not super fresh from Judgment. So why would I put it this low if it seems like, you know, at its worst, it's just reusing stuff. Yeah, the main story. The main story is not too good. If it's not just forgettable, it's kind of contrived, or you don't really get the motivations half the time. The main character's kind of a broken record for a bunch of stuff that you don't quite connect with, or don't quite get behind. The bad guy and stuff is like, it's okay, but it the whole premise and where it all goes doesn't quite work. A lot of it's about like bullying. I wouldn't say it's like Ryukishi tier beating the dead horse, but it doesn't. A conspiracy kind of like mystery thing about with the bullying angle and stuff. It just doesn't quite. It's different in a way from the usual Yakuza stuff, but it just doesn't quite. It doesn't quite pan out for me. I don't want to get too much into the spoilers. I also forget a lot of it. That's part of it. It's just kind of there's kind of a reason they probably haven't done another judgment other than the copyright shit. I would like them to. I think Yamagi or whatever is neat. Kaido's neat. They're fun. It's a good change of pace. I like a bigger change of pace because it is a bit more divorced the main line, but it still is the same rotting skeleton. But like with 8, kind of a shit story. Probably a better story than 8, I would say. Kind of. Well, no, 8 has its moments. Lost Judgment doesn't really have any moments. I've heard Kaido Files is really good. That is the DLC for Lost Judgment. All in really clean focus. Okay.
Yeah, so I don't know, maybe Lost Judgment.
Maybe I'd put it there. I don't know. I still think because of the variety and the general feel of it, like I'd put it. I think on a personal level, I'd put Fist of the North Star above it. I think Lost Judgment's much more polished. He looks like he's like yanking apart the fuck. I gotta put it there just for that. He looks like he's pulling apart these fucking games, man. And that, I feel like this has been memed a bit. This fucking opening the door or whatever. So yeah. I don't know. It's cool. It's at least not like overly. It's not like a 90-hour game telling a shitty story. I don't know. There's Yakuza fatigue there. They throw some variety in. I just don't think it's as big of a jump. Kind of was. I think you could argue Judgment could be mixed around. 5 could be mixed around. I think Kiwami 2, or just 2 in general, can be mixed around. Lost Judgment, maybe you can make the argument mixed around. I think the general feel of this is right, but I would totally respect people moving a couple up and down. I don't think they're like hard picks. Also, because they're so simple. Isshin, I really wasn't super duper into Isshin. In a way, I kind of was. Maybe I'd put it above 3. So, Isshin, I mean, you're like, man, how, it's so different. It is really different. It is set in, is it Meiji era? The era where the West starts coming to Japan, right? The black ships. You play as Sakamoto Ryoma, which he looks like here. And then most of the characters look like other characters. It's almost like a. So, Yakuza fatigue, I think, at this point in the series, we're really set. It doesn't help that the major minigame stuff's not that good. It's a farming thing, kind of like a shitty farming thing. some cute little mini games, but stuff like subquests have like a grind attached to them. You shouldn't really displace the grindiness that Yakuza can have on the side. That you need to go back and forth to these people and give them stuff over and over to like slowly unlock their subquests. Just not interesting in the first place. The side stuff, not super interesting. They bring back the gacha stuff, the, you know, Kwame 2. Six had. That's kind of rough. So just side quest wise, it's kind of whatever. But hey, it's a new location, right? It's olden times. You running around with four stances again, like in Zero, which is cool. I really like that. It's about variety. You got your gun stance, you got your gun with sword stance, you got your just sword stance, you got your cuff. And so it's like Zero in that aspect, which is neat. I enjoy that, but put Ishin above six. We'll see. It's its own story. So it's a story that's very tied to history. You were playing a real person who was a big deal, and in that actual time period, it is very, you know, flowery and awesome. All these moments in history were awesome kind of feel to it. It's like a little ham-fisted at times, especially at the end. But it's kind of goofy fun, right? Like, they're trying to throughout these like big historical messages and stuff with these characters' mouth. But for the most part, it's just not. I don't like the gear system, and I just don't care for much of the main story. I think there's a lot of strong moments with the Shinsengumi and some of the fights. The choreography is awesome. Cinematography is awesome as usual. This time you get swords and stuff, guns. But the problem is just how you interact with the world, just running around in the typical Yakuza way, but this time with grindy subquests, with crappy gear systems that take forever to get through, with shitty like procedural dungeon things you gotta like, with gacha elements that you do on the side if you wanna like really push the gear, and like a main story that's like, yeah, it's tied to history, but like kind of doing its own thing, but also kind of just meanders a bit. Like a lot of it's super forgettable outside the end, and it's just kind of typical bad guy shit. Like, between all of that, despite being in a new location, despite having that cinematography and flash that Yakuza does, despite it being new characters that just act like the old characters, too much of like what's in the soup is just not that good, man. like yeah, man, it's the food analogy, but like, it's a new soup, but it's like, it's made up of like a lot of the same old rotten fucking pieces the last soup had from yesterday kind of thing, and then all the new shit just ends up not really working out very well either. So there's new stuff. I think people generally probably like Ishin, but I just found if you're going for the full experience on it, too much of it being just lopsided and not fitting very. If you're just busting through the story, you haven't played like most Yakuza games, you don't have the Yakuza fatigue, there's probably enough spice there to keep it interesting. Kind of, you know, it's divorced from the mainline, so that's kind of cool. I don't know why Binary Domain's on here. There's probably like a reference to something in there. It's made by RGG. Maybe this creator was memeing. I didn't do this. I didn't set this up. But yeah, it was made by those devs. I haven't played it yet. So in a way, it's still cool. Like, if you really love the Yakuza formula, it'll be fine. Like I said, You know, if you do all the subquests and minigames and stuff, I think you'll find it a bit lacking and a bit needlessly grindy, and like I said, shitty item system and gear system attached to it. It just doesn't, it's not really that fun to fuck around with, and ends up just either making the game a complete joke or just ends up being like needlessly time consuming. No matter which way you go with it, it's kind of whatever. And then a bunch of procedural shit that's just not that fun, that's also insanely. But yeah, for the main thing is the story. Like I said, cool cinematography, but it's just, I don't know, man. It's mostly pretty forgettable. And since it's kind of tied in some ways to history, like, you know, the general beats aren't like too crazy. They just kind of like flash it up a bit. It's okay. I just find it, at this point in the series, I find it too samey, despite being kind of in a, like I said, it's a rotten skeleton with a new set of skin. And that old trick can only work so many times as the skeleton gets more and more rotten throughout the series. So I don't think Isshin kicks up the quality and the content enough for me to put up with it being the same way of doing everything. The story and all the subquests and such is just not good enough. It's still got it the same strengths. I just don't. But I think Gaiden, man, I think that's probably the, I gotta say, dude, I had very little, I really didn't enjoy Gaiden much. That was the small one that came out, the 20 to 30 hour. One that came out in between 8 and the 7. It's to kind of bring back the action, but with Kiryu again, and kind of explain what he's been up to. It feels like a game, especially after 8, that they just made on the side that was never really supposed to, like, even hardly, like, tie in. Like, it almost feels like they just kind of, like, accidentally. Like, it was never part of a plan. Gaiden feels like filler, and 8 treats it like filler. Like, they kind of mention the dead. They talk about the Daidoji Hama, whatever his name is, there until he just gets killed. Like, the events of 8, like, Gaiden just barely, it barely matters. Only the very ending, which is really strong. I got emotionally involved in that. Of Gaiden really even fucking means anything. And that's just reaffirming his thoughts on the kids. There's moments in 8 where you're like, they shoehorn in like flashbacks to Gaiden that feel so forced and out there that, like, you wonder if they even, the teams even knew what each other team was doing during the creation of Gaiden, and they just sort of shared notes at the end, maybe. Like it feels like they're very loose. Like the continuity of them is kind of shit. So. Like, there's a few things they'll throw in, like a cutscene where you're like, oh, he goes and brings Yumi's ring to her grave or the church in eight, but they just kind of like mention it real quick. That was supposed to be like a big thing at the end of Gaiden and stuff. It's just like, it's just kind of whatever. So anyways, Gaiden is like a filler game where they bring back action. It's cute that he has like his dragon style, but then also he has his secret agent style, which you see none of at all in 8. He has like 3 styles. It's Rush, Beast, and Brawler from like 0. He doesn't even have the agent style anymore. Like, it's just completely, no gadgets, no nothing, dude. Just completely forgotten about. But he has those in Gaiden, in the action game. He has like a little Spider-Man like web thing he flips around. And the story is pretty much about him hanging out in the Yakuza Zero, Goro, Majima City, just kind of on a mission. He's like kind of just fucking around, like the motivations of the Daidoji of some of the characters, of the bad guys, of just the driving action always feels so like loose and like slipshod. And I'd have to go back to it to really get the details, but like it just feels very, very rough. I never find myself connected to anything going on. You know, it's still got these big over the top moments and like, you know, there's a cruiser tanker with a giant gambling city inside of it. It's very flashy, but like, it's kind of just like, you're just never connected to what's going on in the story. And you're wanting to know, like, what's up with Kiri? Where are we going? Like, we get he's sad, but like, it just kind of fucks around. And he's supposed to be caring about these people who, like, just kind of treat him like shit. Or he's, like, kind of entrapped in their whole scheme. And it just never quite worked, right? It feels like an inconsequential story outside, like, the very end. Where it just helps you reaffirm character traits. Otherwise, it just kind of meanders in typical, like, Yakuza just bullshit. Sort of melodrama, but like you don't care about the characters, so it doesn't really matter. It's mostly just Yakuza action. And the side content is just weak. It's just not good. It's extremely grindy, like minor fights. With like, there's some subquests that are just like, I don't even remember the subquests. Was there even actual subquests in that game? I don't even remember at this point. It's just nothing interesting. No major mini game really. A lot of small ones and stuff or returning shit, but I mean, you know, billiards is in every game, but I ain't gonna play it. Like I've played enough. So I mean, they had Virtua Fighter 2. I hated fucking playing that game. That was cool, dude. Fucking hated the arcade mode on that. That's a different story. But I respect Virtua. Jesus. It's not a fun, I'm just going to play through Virtua Fighter 2. So, I don't know. I mean, it had your typical, like, it felt very workman to, like, on another level. Like, clearly it's a budget Yakuza game. It's like a $40 one instead. I mean, it's got enough hours you get out of it, but it feels, you know, like they weren't ever pushing it. It's not ambitious. Like they bring back action combat. They tell like a kind of flashy story at times with a couple cute set piece locations. And then it kind of just putzes around. It's just kind of doing stuff. Like it still has the same Yakuza highs of like cinematography and shit and facial animation. And you know, it has a variety of side content, but it doesn't push any of it to the limit. It's not even all that good of stuff within its own series, even compared to like some of the weakest entries. Like even one side shit's almost better at times, man. I mean, if you include all the mini games like billiards and shit, maybe not, but like just new stuff. I find it to be pretty shit. It's the only Yakuza game I'd almost say is kind of just not that good. I don't even know if I would say it is really bad, but like, if you've played all of these games up to this point, this is just, it's not doing much, man. Like I said, the rotten ass skeleton again, this time without even really like a new skin. And what's there is like this patchwork, like just mess that barely fits because of the story and the side content barely holding it up. It's just, I don't know. If you want more details on all of these, I guess you could just go like and watch the end of each one, or I go into it more. Remembering the details and the fine, you know, differences between these can be hard sometimes. And sometimes I mix up some of the video essays and shit I've watched, kind of going back through some of these and me hashing out my own thoughts on them. The problem with a lot of these is sometimes the story is the make or break, and some of the weaker ones, you just have forgettable stories, right? Or they're very samey, right? conspiracies and melodrama and not really forwarding the characters maybe as much as you want, but hey, it has a couple high points. That's a lot of these. So sometimes I'll forget some of the details. Like, they all have subquests, right? Am I gonna remember like 700, 800 subquests? Probably not. Because a lot of them, while fun in the moment, like an 8, I'll probably forget in a week because they're not that great pieces of writing. But they're fun in the moment. Anyways, I'm just kind of explaining like why I don't maybe have a bit more surgical explanation for judgment or guidance. Somehow. I mean, I explain why. Getting into characters and motivations and stuff, I feel like. Moment. It's just, the Yakuza fatigue is part of it, but I also think it's kind of weak. And I still need to go to the rest of the I've not gone. There's so much. I really need to sit down one of these days and go to. So anyways, where would I put 8 right now? Yeah, we probably won't do any more streaming after this tonight. We'll see. Might chill. AliExpress, probably maybe tomorrow. Whenever you get up. Either Hilux or I'll bust through some of those platformers. We'll see. Where would I put 8? And I almost want to put. There's like my objective where I feel like I'd put some of these based on their quality and stuff. And then there's just like how much I just enjoyed them based on where I was in the series. I think this is fine. Like, I mean, Lost Judgment's probably object better than just the North Star. But man, I just like Lost Paradise better. It's just more fun. 8. It's hard, man. I mean, it's obviously the most fresh in my mind. 8's tough, because I think the story sucked in 8. I think the game is really fucking long for what it is, but it has some pretty cool side content. Generally above average subquest writing. Some strong character moments, but then also some really shitty character moments, because there's too many characters without a whole lot going on. It's such an all-over-the-place game. I don't think it's in the upper echelon. In some ways, it's better than 7. But in some ways, it's kind of like a Tears of the Kingdom, where it's like, technically the combat's better, but, like, it should be way better. So it's like, yeah, you could say it's better than 7, but it's like, but really, I feel like it should be a lot better than it is. I don't know. So when I'm doing this tier list, it's like my trajectory through the my journey through the whole series, right? And I think that matters, right? Like, if I could just put each of these games in like a fucking vacuum, maybe it would be different, right? Like, maybe I would think Gaiden is way better than like 1 because the combat is way more interesting or some shit. I don't know. I probably wouldn't still, because 1 has probably a better story. But, you know, the side content, because they keep Yakuza's series that keeps building off of the games before it, and how, like, they'll make a mini game and then they'll just leave it in every game after. You know, they'll put an idea and then they'll just leave it in, and they'll just keep leaving it. It's like the clan creator thing with the gacha and stuff. They'll just keep leaving it. So they kind of are building off each other in a lot of ways. So you could say objectively that because of all these extra features and the visuals and how they've really found their footing and a lot of stuff, that maybe in a way they keep getting better. Granted, storytelling, big changes, not all those really work out. That's where I feel like even objectively you could say that there's still some variance despite them kind of building off of each game as you. So 8's like, got that. Where they kind of sort of, I mean, the combat's pretty much the same, but they kind of change it a little. Uh, And they sort of, you know, are banking off of characters that have been developed in two different kind of chunks of story, like Ichiban and all of Kiryu's stuff. So a lot of its emotional beats kind of are built up, not from its own game, but from other games. So it's kind of like how the shitty new Star Wars movies try to, like, use old stuff because they can create their own new thing, sort of. Not quite the same, but, like, they didn't do anything in particular new with Kiryu, but they did bank off of stuff that was built through other games, and that's something that, like, you can't just do in one game. It's a very particular feeling having, like, a 10-game history with somebody. So it's like, they knew what they were doing on some of that, but even then, it's not as satisfyingly done as you'd like. Where would I say? It is. I'm trying to decide if I want to put it, like, here, or if I want to put it, like, I don't know. Like, part of me is like, oh yeah, I'll just put it next. It's got pretty decent major mini games. Not as nice as Sevens at times. Not as addicting. You know, it's got some fun character moments. It's got a new location that's high. Generally, the subquests are all above, like I said, average. You know, it's got those, but then it's also like, man, really should be way better in the combat and the back-end RPG element than it is. Like, it's still all the same problems from 7. Fun, but, like, it just should be more. That we still haven't had a satisfying end with serious stuff. That there's so many, like, kind of, like, man, that means it's just like, I think if you rated a tier list of main stories, this one would probably hit pretty low. I mean, this one would be like, if I were to put it in like a tier list of just like main stories, like, if you don't count the subquest stuff for Kiryu, I think this game's story, any kind of story about it, is saved by the Kiryu chapter, that he first goes to Japan, the very beginning with Ichiban is really good, and then all the side stuff with Kiryu, and then generally some of the subquests with Ichiban. I think if you didn't have that side stuff, this would probably be like here as far as main stories go. Like, Gaiden's worse, but like, it ain't much better, man. I think what makes it okay is that it does have pretty strong major mini games. It generally has decent side stuff. It does have the moments that cinch, sorta, or you feel something like with Date and all that, that kind of, if you've gone through the whole journey, feel pretty good. You kind of are invested in the Kiryu thing. I think if you've not been through the whole journey, I mean, well, it's hard to say. You're not going to be as invested in those things that I was, but you're probably not going to have as much Yakuza fatigue, so you probably would put it a little higher. I think it's still good. I think it's still solid. I would probably put it as like a middling kind of one. On a personal level, I like it less than most of these. On a, like, where should I put it kind of level, I feel like maybe I should, you know, I don't know, man. This one's tough. Where in here would I put it? I would say I probably like 7 better. I think 8 maybe has better things about it. I like that it's Hawaii, but like, it has too many big problems. It's not a bad, but I don't think any. In a way, I could put it down here, man. Like, but I had like an active like dislike three while important. I might even put you because of three above. Eight. Probably put it in here. I you can make an argument that it's worse than this and it's above this. I think it really depends on who you are and how you'd go about it. Lost Judgment has a pretty bad story, but this has a really shit. That was really fucked. Combat. You know, I'm gonna put 8 like right here. This, I think this is where it about hits for me. I think it's the bottom of the middle for me. I think people might disagree there. Critics definitely would. This game was like one of the highest critic games of the year. As far as big releases. But I would say this. I'm okay with it. Like, yes, the side stuff in Yakuza 1's rough, but it tells a much more simple, focused story that I find a bit more interesting. You give a little credit for being fucking, you know, first two. Yeah, you're not as tired of a lot. And this is a tier list based on the journey. I played them in order outside of Zero being my first of release order, essentially. I think that's important to think in here. I think if you look at this and it's just like, this is just like the raw, this one's better than this. In a way that probably is still true, but I think stuff like 8 throws kind of a spanner in the gears there. Because in a way 8 is better than a lot of these, but I think where we're at, Ishin's another one, where we're at, I'm kind of like, all right. We need to be better than that. Yeah, I guess that's where I'm at with it. Anyways, I had fun with this. I don't know if anybody gave a fuck about my random thoughts on Yakuza. I should stop after stream, maybe try Judgment one day was on point. I think if you don't like Zero, or if you're not like all about Zero, then yeah, you can just stop there. Yeah, I would say it doesn't get better in any huge way. Had fun listening? Well, thank you. Yeah, appreciate you guys. I mean, I have fun just talking about it. I really like, I mean, yeah, if there's more discussion, I'm sure that'd always be better, but I just like kind of just going through thoughts and invested in these games and games in general. So I don't know, I guess it's cool doing the thought experiment. Yeah, I don't know. Like I said, Zero is just one of the best stories in it. Five is just super ambitious, and it does tie in characters and variety in a way. If you've played the games before Five, that is cool. Judgment, just this is a really clean, kind of polished, new story in a familiar formula. So it's kind of just like a high quality Yakuza game, but it is still a Yakuza game. But really, it's like, if you start with Zero and it's like, it's good, but you're not like, oh dang, this was really sweet. One through four are not, I mean, two is cool. And maybe you would like the originals more. I don't know. A lot of people say Kiwami 2 is in a travesty. And 2 is like the shit. I mean, 1 and 2 are definitely more moody games. I have watched the stuff on the originals. I think for the most part, you know, you're getting less variety. You're getting less production value. You're getting less side stuff. And then by the time you get to 3, you're getting stories that are wearing way too big of fucking pants for, big pants? I don't know if that's what I don't think that's the right wording for it. That really start jumping the shark a bit. They start ballooning out a little. I think if you really are like, should I give Mainline a try? Just bust through the story of 1. It wouldn't take that long. And then if you're not dying due to, and if you really, you're like, all right, dude, that, I just can't, you know, too, nah, not for me, then just stop. I really, that's like if you're into zero and you can get through two, I think that's like the point, the final point, right? Like if you want to try a little more, go through one, Kwame one and two, and just do the main story, then like that's a kind of, I think if you're not in by two, three is not a good, not that good. Four, while it mixes it up, has the same kind of dullness and conspiracy shit. And like I said, in 5 years, I feel like you kind of need to play some of the other ones to really get the full deal on, and then really kind of downhill from there. Like seven's neat, but like it has a lot of issues. I don't know. I like them all. I don't hate any of these except Beak Gaiden and Ishin. I'm kind of iffy on. I think it's a solid series, but I definitely think there's your litmus test. I definitely think there's your like gates where you find out if you're into it or not with one or two games. Yeah, that's kind of my thing. Is like for me, I didn't know for sure. I was just like, oh man, Zero is cool. I'm gonna start going through the other ones as the remakes come out, and then I'll start going through the rest. And it's like, I'm like, oh shit, like. You know, some of these aren't all that awesome, but some of them are kind of cool. And it's like, you know, but I really like, you know, the goofy storytelling, but then also the stories aren't always that great. And I think if you kind of know where the series is, there's a little less hype that a lot of the back half of the series is in the bottom of most people's lists is probably not the best. Granted, the spinoffs like Judgment and Seven and stuff are higher, right? So it's not like the series generally just fails, but it's like, you know, think about it, like, you know, well, I shouldn't say the back half. The game peak in the middle, in a way, it's like one and two, it's all over the place when you really think about it. It's like, because five's pretty good and it's kind of in the middle, and Judgment's like a spinoff, and Zero's kind of in the middle as well. But then you get stuff like Ishin. It's kind of a roller coaster. I think generally the newer stuff, because of Yakuza fatigue. Hey, everybody. Yeah, thanks for hanging out. It's a little lower. But then the early ones are kind of just weak, like 3 and 1 and 4 a bit. But then they'll still have your occasional like good ones like Judgment, but then also your occasional sneakers like Boss Judgment. It's all over the place. But Yakuza fatigue is a real thing, man. Like, these games are precision engineered to a certain extent, like almost like an MMO, where they know how much they want to reuse, and it's a very big part of cranking these out is pretty quickly with full, huge mocap stories and all this new content. You couldn't probably put out Yakuza games as quickly as they do with the general quality level they do if they didn't reuse so much stuff. And it's just something that they just kind of keep doing, and they just don't stop. And there's an extent where it's like, enough's kind of enough. Like, they need to shake up more than just a new map kind of thing. And I think some people don't care, but most people haven't played all the Yakuza games, so it kind of depends, right? And they do, there is payoff for people who've played all of them. So like, it does, I would recommend it. Most people probably have not played everything when they play 8. That is fine. But like, there is something missed there, but there's also something gained because you're not as tired of the formula. It's a tough one. I think overall, just as a general final-ish thing, it's a good series. I think it's a solid series. I think it's very unique and has storytelling, and it's over the top kind of crime drama, cinematic focus kind of feel to it. In its dense open world, where it's more focused on all sorts of stuff and kind of a more living, breathing kind of like cityscapes and stuff, it is unique, and it is worth at least trying out some of the high points. Cry Zero, High Judgment. If you're really into it, keep working through them. Two's, I think, the final gate, where if you're not into it at that point, it's probably okay just to be done. Yeah. It's also a series, like I said, that's sometimes plagued with rough stories, with jumping the shark, and not just in tone, but and just trying to kind of balloon out. It's kind of like a shonen, where they just, the scale and all that, like, it gets too far removed from its strength, which is character work. It doesn't forget it entirely. Like, even in this game, there was really strong character moments I got a little more emotionally involved in, but it just doesn't quite hit enough, and as often, and for, like, the runtime of stuff like 8, where it's like 90 hours if you do everything, or not even everything, just
most shit.
It's just like, alright, man, you know, the veneer of, like, all of the unique stuff Yakuza does run out eventually. And I think they could get you back on that. They kind of did a Judgment, you know, they kind of do a little bit with 7, but I think they need to do way more to shake up at this point, in my opinion. We will see, though. Yeah, and I get not being into the series in general. Like I said, there's a very specific type of melodrama and cutscene heavy flash and stuff. You know, if you don't like the mixed tones and comedy and all that, like, I get that. But it does have nuance. It does have character work. It does have consistency and characterization that a lot of series don't have. Like, Kiri is a very, very fun, interesting character. It's written pretty well generally. There's the off moments. I mean, he's in like every fucking game. So it's kind of a cool thing to see that. It's not something you get very often, but they stumble. Anyways, I guess that's about it. There's a lot more to say on it, and I mean, I'd be down to discuss what the hell you guys. Overall, good series, but we'll get fatigued. And you'll get fatigued much quicker, depending on how much you like some of the high point entry points. The only problem starting with 0 is it is a high point, and you only can kind of go down from there. Not like really far down, but like it is kind of the high point. So it's a great starting place, but it's also a cursed starting place because it is a high point. Oh. It's also a high point in a way, possibly because it is the first for a lot of people. I think it's a high point in quality, but also it's like you do get used to a lot of what they do. Like I said, if I played 0 again right now, I'd probably be pretty into the story, but I'd probably be pretty tired of everything else. Probably. So, anyways, that's it for now. I do plan on doing the 4 other Yakuza, 5 other Yakuza things I haven't done. The 5 right here, so Black Panther 1 and 2, the PSP ones. These might be different enough just because of them being PSP games and seemingly have totally new cast, which could be cool. Kenzen might do if they remake it, or if I might just play fan translation someday. This is, I think, came out right after 3. It's probably got shit combat and a questionable story. I don't expect this one to be super good. They remade fucking Isshin first. It's like a couple hundred years after, but like, it also said this has some problematic stuff in it. Not sure how to translate. And then Dead Souls, which is supposed to be like the worst. It's like a zombie shooting one, but I'm almost like interested in what the fuck that's all about. I like to do kind of files, but I'll probably watch it, but Streets of Comrades is like 20 minutes. We'll just run through it at some point. And we'll just kind of add back onto this as we go. Anyways, I mentioned this at the end of 8. Maybe it was during this. I don't know. I've been at it for a while. But, I think this series needs to take a fucking break. I think they need to freshen it up in a lot more ways than just adding a new location. And tying in more characters from each kind of like chunk of the story. They kind of did that with Judgment. They've kind of done that with like Fist of the North Star and shit. But I think the skeleton needs probably a bigger shakeup. How much can you shake it up with that? With it without it still being Yakuza? I think you could at least refresh a lot of stuff. You know, animations, the feel of combat. Tightening up, you know, gear systems and stuff if you're gonna do that. Bringing the scope down. Are they ever gonna just let the Yakuza story with Daigo and all them just ever go? I mean, since they didn't even fully like finish up the Kiryu thing in this, I feel like you got another one just like this. Which, hey man, if you could at least keep the scope down and tighten it up, whatever, I guess, but it's not like I'm tired of Kiryu. It's like I'd like to see him get his thing, but it's like I also feel like, you know, I'm getting like a kernel of like Kiryu's story, you know, a kernel of like his progression, like 30 minutes in every 50-hour game, right? So it's like, yeah, he does a lot, but he's just kind of like fighting the next monster of the week, right? Like, is anybody gonna remember Aiba or whatever his name was? I already almost forgot his name, right? Was that even his? I don't think that was his name in the next game. Like, no. Like, he's just another goon dude that we beat up, and that's how it feels when you're in there, like Bryce Fairchild, right? Like, like whatever, dude. Like, maybe he'll appear as a bar owner, like the fucking Goofy 3 villain did. I don't know. So those are kind of the things I'd like. I'd like them to freshen it up in a larger way, or at least just kind of give us just a really quality entry, right? Really tight story, you know, all the systems are just kind of really working together really well. Ditch, yeah, exactly, like all the other, like Kashiwagi's back after he got Gatling gunned in 3, or, you know, the villain, the goofy villain, the American villain in 3 is back as a fucking, you know, fucking, after he fell off of a fucking building. Mine pulled him off of a building in 3, and somehow Mine's dead, and this guy's alive, and he's a bartender too. I love a dude who got shot in the head. He was a returning villain in a lot of the games. Literally shot in the forehead is back as a fucking weapons dealer. You know, like they don't care. It's just goofy, and that, I mean, that's kind of the fun of it. Is like they know to not give a fuck and just have fun with it when it's right. But then sometimes also they fuck it up. In moments they really shouldn't. Like in 8, there's a lot of moments where I'm like, all right, man, they need to be smarter than this. They need to like kind of flesh these moments out and care about these characters and kind of have them on display here, or, you know when to not just have this be like another episode. You know, there needs to be some kind of driving force that I care about more, and that they just don't. Like, there's a point where things can be too contrived, not in a fun, goofy way, like, hey, a giant squid attacked us. Like, that's just kind of goofy, you can accept it. But, like, it's harder to accept, like, not caring about, like, the villains, or getting, like, this goofy Days of Our Lives drama about half-brothers told by just some Daigo in a fucking shack somewhere, like instead of in like an actual story moment where we've actually learned about this character. Like, there's contrivances and like hand of the author moments where you're just like, all right, man, like I just don't like, it feels like they're just kind of reaching or just kind of forcing stuff that don't work. But then there's moments where it's just contrived and goofy, like somebody just gets shot in the head for no reason randomly in like Yakuza 4 or something. It's like, it's just fun, stupid shit, right? They're really good at, like, doing those contrived, like, goofy, just accept it moments, just have fun with them. Like, you never really want to sit there and, like, get analytical about, like, a Yakuza game's, like, cr- chronology and like how airtight the logic is of everything, but you need a little bit, right? Just a little bit. And usually I find that in the character moments to be where it needs to come in, or to avoid repetition. Like I said, in this one, they just fall in a trap like all the time by the bag. And then at the end, he just bites him with his fist anyways. Like, it's just like, and there was nothing else to him. Like, if he was just like a character that was interesting, like, I wouldn't probably care about the how. I'd just be about the what with him and the who. But you don't have that, so all you have left is this kind of slipshod, contrived bullshit, so. What I'm trying to say is, like, they're really good at, like, making you not care about the logic behind stuff, but then also you kind of need some of it. And so with resurrecting wacky NPCs, like, I don't mind, it's funny. Because it is minor. But also, like, would anybody even care enough about these ones to have them ever just come back? Like, probably not. They're just very dull. I mean, it's funny. In Yakuza, you tend to forget some of the final bosses because they are just lame. And despite supposed to be these climax, right? It's really about other stuff.
Or that just speaks to how shitty the conspiracy stories are. Like, why I was like,
Glasses guy in 6. Mine, I guess, was memorable enough in 3. Ryota's good in 2. Obviously, Nishiki's interesting in 1. But then once you get into conspiracy, like, 4 is like 4 bosses at 1. Like, 5's like the dude's fucking weird son in one area, and then like another guy somewhere. It's like, okay, and 6 is like the glasses guy. And it's like, who? 7. I think you're fighting some some Yakuza guy, but it was also like his brother, dude. I don't even know if you fought his brother. I think you did. Like, I don't know. Once the conspiracies start getting like Judgment, like, I guess the Judgment one was killer. Like, you remember some of them, but it's like, I find they start getting because the character stuff is where it's strong, and then the conspiracies kind of dilute the character. Anywho, anyways, I'd recommend Yakuza if you for sure, but like I said, try 0. If you hate 0, don't play anymore. If you own 0, but like, hey, I want to try some more, work your way up through 2, can't handle it, then just stop. Or, you know, you can try Judgment. Yep, that's about it. There's probably more I could get into. We could talk all day about you. By talking in circles and forgetting enough stuff. Anyways, it was fun for me. Hopefully it was some kind of informative. If anybody wants to try these out, or just, I don't know. I should go back through these VODs and like rewatch them and like analyze how I talk about shit. Try to improve. It's a tough one with this series, man. There's just like the very sameness to it, and like a running story and the fatigue, and how they're more about being wide as an ocean and deep as a puddle, but then with the stories they go a little harder. And there's a lot going on there. Obviously, taste is one thing for sure. It's got a very over-the-top. Yeah. All right, guys. I think that'll be it for me today. I'm going to watch the end of some people playing this and see some words on it, and more likely just probably hit the hay. Tomorrow, could start Dragon's Dogma 2. I think I might just take a day. don't know, maybe we'll do some Helldivers, but might do a Hylic or something. Because Steam Share is not going to be quite the same at some point. There's a bunch of little 3D platformers, like those like hour-long ones. I'd like to get through Hylix 2. I need to do Hylix 1. Stuff like Patrick Parabox. I was going to maybe do... Maybe Needy Streamer Overload. Taiji. If you guys got any opinions on those, I would like to hear them. Not Hylix, because I know I'll be playing those, but... Patrick Parabox, Needy Streamer Overload, Tide. Any of those are like, wow, these really suck. Play them. Wouldn't mind hearing that. I've heard Patrick's Parabox is cool though, so I'll probably. Anyways, yeah, we'll probably start one of those. Probably most likely Hylic. Two, maybe tomorrow. Depends on what I got going on. I mean. Parabox is solid. Yeah, I think you and Adri, I think that's Taiji, I'm not sure. It looks like a game I would like. Came out a couple years ago. Solve puzzle panels and uncover the meaning of the symbols within. Explore dense world or secrets or hidden pins. I kind of really like the witness. Those are, I mean, I got a bunch on here like Super Kiwi 64 and Tori 3D and 2 and MacBat, all that shit. Yeah, just let me know. I'll try to make that be on when you're on. I think that's kind of from your list stuff I was gonna do. All those platformers can probably be done in a day, and those other ones would probably. Day. Patrick's Parabox, though. Is this supposed to be a long one? It seems like a short. Maybe not. All day. It's probably one of those games that has a bunch of extra shit. We'll see. Yeah, maybe. I might. Shit's on the rest of them. I'll play that one last. Yeah, Goto's gonna be around for that. I'm trying to pick. Anywho, so yeah, that might happen, or I won't do any of that. We'll start Dragon's Dogma 2. I'll just play Helldivers or something, but I feel like I need a break from like 100 hour long games for a day or two at least. So. Might do Hylix. Or something. Anywho. I will catch you guys later. Thank you very much for, you know, have a comfy arc. Well, we're getting into, we're getting out of the new super long RPG. Unicorn Overlord, Dragon's Dogma, and really there's not, I'll be doing some random stuff here, like Space for the Unbound and Shadows Overload. You know. Another blade in like a month. We'll have to see what's leaving Game Pass and shit soon. I got a lot of indie stuff I really want to dig into. I've been kind of feeling some old stuff too. So I'll just kind of play whatever I want. Yeah, that's the thing that I was like, I need to be ready for Unicorn Overlord. It's supposed to be great, so it's like, I'm sure I'll be fine with it, but like, I'm like, I've got somebody I follow who's been playing and he's like on day like 9, he has like 8 hours a day. So, yeah, there's another one, dude. Because you know I'll be playing a shitload of it. We'll see what happens. And then Dragon's Dogma is, I'm sure, another 60, 70 plus. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I might try not to. I mean, I say that. I was going to try to do that with this game, and I ended up with a 90-hour playtime, because the side stuff was fine. I don't want to just do grindy stuff. Like, if it's interesting content, I would probably do it. But if it's just like, you can just fill out a map, I'm going to try to not do that. I don't care about just filling a checklist. I try to avoid that these days. But I also don't play games I just fucking hate. Usually end up doing shit. Anyways, it's Saturday, so I put this in the mail today. Doesn't matter. I'll just do it. This back, and hopefully I'll get Shadows Overloading or Unicorn Overlord. Kind of would prefer Shadows Overloading at this point, just something quick I can do in the middle of Dragon's Dogma 2. Can't really slide in a quick Unicorn Overlord during Dragon's Dogma. You know. Yeah, and if Sandland sucks, I'm taking that off. I'll probably play Stellar Blade either way because it'll be a short action game. And Ass is pretty cool. Really, there's not much else. I'm going to try to get in a lot of old stuff. Backlog. I mean, with this other stuff I got coming up and then all these long RPGs, that's going to be a lot of April. We'll see in May. I'm really thinking about doing the dual playthrough of Thousand Year Door just for myself. People probably wouldn't want to watch that. But I'm kind of interested. I've brought it up before, I'll bring it up again. So the idea would be that the Paper Mario Thousand Year Door remake coming out in May 23rd, and I thought about playing the original at the exact same time and just running in room by room, side by side, just to have a super comparison playthrough. Now the problem is, I don't know how to do two games, one controller between those versions. I could emulate one, sure. Maybe that would help some way, but I'm like, can I do, like, control my Switch with the new version and then like either my GameCube, my Wii, or an emulator at the same time? That would be preferred. I just play them literally at the same time and then I just like desync one when I need to, because there's gonna be RNG and shit. But like, I'd probably just have to play it literally like room by room. Or I just play with two controllers, two hands, and then try to do it at the same time. Which I could. I'd probably get used to it. It'd probably be funny. Just literally two man playing it. I mean, the fights would have to probably separate. I kind of just want to do it just to be like, oh, you know, this is the room by room. I mean, it's probably going to be a lot of the same thing where it's like they ruin the art style or something. But, I mean, maybe not, you know. I think it'd be kind of fun. I'm really thinking about it. June's pretty packed. Because I might do SMT5 Vengeance. Kind of want to see what's going on with that. And then it's a week after that, Elden Ring. Which, I won't be playing it right away. I'll be probably family sharing that. And then it's Dawn Trail. I'll probably be playing Dawn Trail for 2 to 4 weeks, probably. Especially if I do any grinding. The story will take at least a few weeks, or at least... Dawn Trail will be an FF14 snook. System Shock's getting a console release, but I don't know if I want to play System Shock 1 on console. I don't really like playing shooters other than stuff like Vanquish or some shit, even then. Anything other mouse came. Anyways, I'll catch you guys later. Thank you very much.